Okay.
Oh, I don't see them. Let me see. Let me, maybe I'm on the wrong screen. We got three pages, so we got 62 folks so far. Where's Paul at? Paul, I can't find where you're on here. I can find your picture. Oh, there he is. He's my, see him. Hey, Paul, what's going on, man?
What's up, you guys?
Oh, man, it's good to have you. Hey, how are things down there in San Diego today? Probably the same.
Things are good. Things are super good. My book actually just went live. I haven't announced it. It's like a super secret link on Amazon. The print copy is now just live, and I'm going to announce it like in the next 2 days. So,
all right. Well, let me just welcome Paul. Paul is arguably going to be writing the second best book ever. I just give you a hard time, Paul. No, I'm sure it's great. I saw Paul showed me a hard copy. It's a ton of references, ton of science. I'm sure Paul has done just a wonderful job. I look forward to reading it in my quote unquote spare time, which I have none, but I, you know, it's like when I get on a plane or something like that, I'm going to definitely get through that thing. But Paul, welcome. We got a whole bunch of people anxiously. We already got some questions queued up. So I really just want to spend time, you know, why don't you spend a few minutes just chatting about the book so people know kind of what's in it in general, and then we can get to all the millions of questions that people have. That's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm definitely going to get you a copy, Shawn. I'll send you a PDF today. So the book is, like Shawn said, the second best book. Well, who knows? We'll see. Do you ever see that? Do you ever see like Conor McGregor and John Jones got together, and Conor McGregor's like there was just like he made this like really really ambiguous post about who the GOAT was, you know, like who the greatest of all time was. He was like, yeah, you know, so that's kind of like that.
Yeah, and, I mean, I got to tell you, John Jones looking a little shaky when he went his mostly plant based diet. You know, you got to see.
He didn't look awesome against Rays, did he? So, I mean, the book is just kind of how I think about carnivore. It starts in the beginning. The first two chapters are about kind of the anthropology, the ethnography, the growth of the human brain, a lot of the stuff that I kind of learned from Miki Bendor and other anthropologists. I did a podcast with Bill von Hippel, who is really interested in, he wrote a book called The Social Leap. And so we talked about some of the stuff with him, and then I talked about that in the book. So the first two chapters are about kind of the anthropology, the ethnography, where humans have come from, the fact that human brains got so much bigger once we started eating meat. That's pretty hard to deny. It's like this critical, critical part of human evolution. It's a piece. It's like this magical spark that probably made us human. And then the second chapter is all about the sort of the dawn of the agriculture revolution, how our health cratered. You know, that's really not surprising to anyone here. The decreases in human health, the decreases in evidence of health, and the increase in bone lesions, decreased stature, decreased humerus and femur length in people who are post Neolithic revolution. So then the third through the seventh chapters are all about plant toxins. And what's so crazy is that, you know, as I took about 7 months to write the book, and I just kept wanting to add more plant toxins, and there were definitely things I wanted to put in. I was just thinking about something this morning that I wish I'd put in the book that I didn't. But anyway, so then I talk about, I have a whole chapter on isothiocyanates. And these are not, this is not an inclusive list of plant toxins, but I had a chapter on isothiocyanates, a chapter on polyphenols. Isothiocyanates are not polyphenolic. Polyphenols, I had a chapter on lectins, and a chapter on oxalates. And I also talked a little bit about salicylates and some of that other stuff in there as well. So many toxins. I did not talk about saponins or prolaminins or just like these, I just could have written chapter after chapter on plant toxins. That was kind of how I thought of like the broad regions, the broad categories of plant toxins. And I then broke it down and shared the research about those things. There was somebody interesting. I posted on Instagram today about a Twitter post I did a couple days ago. And I just said, my overarching to the way I think about the carnivore diet, and I think you would probably all agree with this, I'm pretty sure Shawn would agree with this, is principle one, animal foods, primarily meat and organs, have been the center of human existence and are healthy for humans and are a healthy part of any human diet. Principle two, plants contain toxins that may be triggering for some people immunologically. And I said toxins and anti-nutrients. And somebody on Twitter was like, what are, like a doctor talking about anti-nutrients? What are, like, that's not even real. And I was like, what? I was kind of blown away that somebody would debate the fact that plants had anti-nutrients. But that's basically the broad category that I was in the whole second section of the book after the anthropology section is all the toxins, the research I could find on the toxins. And in the Instagram comments from somebody today, somebody said, show me a study that shows that plants are harmful. And I was thinking, read the book. Like, there are maybe 50 to 60 studies out of the 600 that I reference in the book that are, you know, things that were showing that plant toxins are actually potentially harmful to humans. Are they equally toxic for all humans? Probably not. Are some people more sensitive to different things? Probably so. So there's variability in how we're sensitive, but to suggest that plants do not have toxins or entirely benevolent, I think misses a broad category of plant botany and all this other kind of stuff. So then
let me just interject. And, you know, even you, when, you know, and I've looked through this literature as well, you know, and again, writing the book, mine was written a year before it was published, and I was like, man, I would put more in, you know, but you know, when you're working with a publisher, it's kind of a thing. But the thing we see is, you know, they generally, a lot of this research out there on plant stuff, they only publish positive findings too. And so there's probably, you know, it's kind of like it's even biased when you're looking at the literature, but even when you look through it, there's thousands of compounds we probably haven't even fully identified or tested. And certainly we don't, all they do when they do toxicology is, does it make you acutely sick and does it cause a genetic change that we can see, and all this stuff when it looks at, you know, depression, joint pain, that stuff's never even tested, which is kind of interesting. So even the fact that you can find all this stuff, it's almost incidental that they publish this stuff. And it's probably, if we were to look at the negative effects and actively research negative effects, we would probably have thousands upon thousands of articles we could find.
That's a great point. And I mean, Bruce Ames points that out in that famous paper that you and I have both pointed to, you know, 99% plant pesticides, 99.9% all natural. He says there are thousands of plant toxins. Only a small amount have even been studied. And granted, the majority of the polyphenols that he's talking about and isothiocyanates that haven't studied are studied in cell culture. And Tommy Wood and I have had conversations about this. How good is cell culture? Is the DNA of cell culture cells more likely to break? Yeah, probably. But at the same level, like if a compound is breaking DNA, especially causing double-stranded breaks and micronuclei, which are things that happen in cells when cells divide in cell culture and they've had chromosomal breaks, they make these micronuclei with fragments of broken DNA. If plant compounds are causing that, it kind of raises this question, like, could they be doing that in humans? Probably. And then the question becomes, what's the important dose? How's it affecting different people? But to deny that plants don't have toxins is kind of to put our head in the sand. The next section of the book is probably my favorite section. It's a debunking section. There are four chapters in this section, and I debunk the myths that I think are most prominent with regard to plant and animal foods. So the chapter 8 is about debunking the myth that plants are superfoods. This was a fun chapter to write. I've kind of thought more and more about this since the writing of the book. I compare plant and animal nutrients together, and I say, which are the most bioavailable? Where do we get our nutrients from? And then I think one thing that you and I should talk about more, Shawn, and really push more in our messaging, is all of these nutrients that are present really only in appreciable quantities in animal foods. You've talked about this before, choline, carnitine, carnosine, taurine, anserine, B12, K2. People want to say like, oh, there's not enough vitamin C in meat, or there's no vitamin C in meat. And we know that's not true. But the plant-based advocates, I think, really can't argue with, there's really no way to get enough choline or carnitine, et cetera, of any of these nutrients eating a plant-based diet. We need animal foods to be optimal. And I think once you accept that, it's like, wow, if you can't get vitamin K2 from plants, and vitamin K2 is clearly beneficial, and we are very questioning regarding how well we are able to convert K1 to K2 or other things like anserine or carnosine. Many of these we can make a small amount of the human body, but once we actually look at how much we need to be optimal, we're just not going to get it from plants. Like, that to me just really pulls the rug out from any plant-based argument and says, how could we possibly rely on only plants? And I don't necessarily mean to paint this as like a polar argument between plant, all plant, or all animal, but I think it kind of says we need animal foods in our life. And then the chapter 9 is about the meat and cancer myths. And chapter 10 is about meat and the microbiome. So I try to debunk all these things. You know, this meat and cancer myth is so insidious. Actually, I think chapter 9 is about fiber and how we don't need fiber in the human diet. I go through all the studies that I've seen about fiber, potentially dangerous, all the downsides to fiber, et cetera. And then chapter 10 is about cancer and the microbiome. Is it going to affect my microbiome? Am I going to get cancer from eating red meat? Kind of debunk, go through all that. And then chapter 11 was one of the more challenging ones to write in the book. It's all about LDL and lipids and how a rising LDL in the setting of a low carbohydrate, ketogenic, carnivore diet is probably nothing to worry about. It's a very controversial chapter. That chapter has probably 130 references in it on its own. And that was a challenging one to write. And, you know, a lot of that chapter is kind of speculation. What is really causing atherosclerosis? If you guys have heard my podcast, which is called Fundamental Health, I've had a lot of people on there talking about lipids. It's a kind of a pet project of mine, trying to understand what is the current understanding of where atherosclerosis comes from. I interviewed Malcolm Kendrick, which I'm going to post soon, but it seems to all be starting with endothelial damage. And it's really hard to make a case that native non-oxidized LDL is going to damage the endothelium in any way. And so you can make a reasonable case that a higher LDL is better in the setting of insulin resistance when you look at all the data that that LDL has a protective role or a role in the immune system. So I was joking with the folks from Ancestral Supplements. We want a shirt that says LDL of 400 or bust, you know, like LDL, the bigger, the better, you know, if my LDL is bigger than yours, you know, it's like that totally flips the whole thing on its head and says, wait a minute. Like, I think it was Robert Siwas. I always mispronounce his name on Instagram, who had a patient that said it, asked him, will my LDL, will my bad cholesterol go up on a ketogenic diet? And he said, you don't have bad cholesterol, you have bad information. Oh, that was so well put. Like, you don't have bad cholesterol, you have bad information. I don't think LDL is a harmful molecule in the human body. Contextually is very important. And then chapter 12 and 13 are all about how to do a carnivore diet. And then chapter 13 is about pitfalls. I talk about, this has probably been the most interesting chapter and kind of the one that I kept refining and wish I could refine more. Like, why do we get the diarrhea with carnivore? How do we work on it? What about constipation? What about keto flu? What about fatigue? What about insomnia? What are the things that I'm seeing the most working with people coming up on a carnivore diet, and how do we really modify those in the best way possible within an animal-based perspective? And then chapter 14 is kind of the summary chapter, and I talk about regenerative agriculture in that one because I knew there had to be an environmental chapter in the book. And then I've got some frequently asked questions at the back. So that's the book, you guys.
Awesome, Paul. Look forward to it. I'm sure everybody, hopefully all of us here will pick up a copy and add it to our library of arsenal, because like I said, the more of us that are in this space, I mean, it's literally a war we're engaged in. And I know that this seems a bit hyperbolic language, but it really is. I mean, the future is us or the plant-based synthetic food, which obviously I don't want to see. But I'm going to get to a couple questions, Paul, if you don't mind, that are out here. And there's a whole, and I apologize, I might not be able to get everybody's question. I've only got an hour. I got to do an interview here a little bit, unfortunately, after this. But so somebody's asking about your thoughts on things like CBD and marijuana. I mean, a lot of people, that's obviously very popular. It's anti-inflammatory, supposedly. A lot of people use it for pain. I know Brett's smiling. He's a guy that... So I wonder what your thoughts are on that. Is it helpful potentially conditionally? Is it just all bad? Is it all good? Is it the miracle that people put it out to be? You know, is it context dependent? Go ahead, Paul.
Yeah, I think it's context dependent. I think that one of the points that I hope I got across in the book was that I'm not denying that plant compounds have physiologic effects in the human body and can be used pharmaceutically. I think that we know that, right? Penicillin saved many lives, right? It's a mold, you know, toxin basically that kills bacteria. It's a mold defense weapon that kills bacteria. Psilocybin, very psychoactive molecule, very effective in trials in the VA for depression, anxiety, and PTSD, things like this, right? Plant molecules, fungal molecules do have effects in the human body. What I want to draw attention to with the book is the idea that we have to consider them in the context and consider all of their effects throughout the body. What so often appears to happen is that supplement manufacturers, pharmaceutical companies want to focus on the one thing that a molecule, whether it's synthetic or of plant or fungal origin, does well, but ignore the entirety of what it does in the human body. Sulforaphane is a great example of this, right? You can point to sulforaphane activating NRF2, increasing glutathione in the short term, but when you zoom out and you look at the entirety of what these goitrogenic molecules like sulforaphane with goitrin GOITRIN probably being worse than sulforaphane are doing in the human body, we start to see some pretty negative effects. So then we always have to ask the question, do the benefits outweigh the risks? I think for the majority of us, they do not. And so often what we are focused on with supplements, curcumin, resveratrol, is the benefit. You know, I think that my friend David Sinclair is guilty of this with resveratrol, getting myopically focused. What is the benefit of resveratrol versus what are the risks? We are not told very often. This goes back to Sean's original point. We are often not told of the entirety of the effects of these molecules in the human body. When we take a molecule like ibuprofen or metoprolol or lisinopril or Lipitor, which is atorvastatin, there's a package insert, right? There's a piece of paper that comes and it says, these are the side effects of this medication. We don't get this with plant molecules. We don't have to get that when you take resveratrol or sulforaphane or curcumin or CBD, but there is a package insert. All of these molecules have side effects throughout the human body. They're kind of foreign to us, and most molecules do this. So what is the entirety? In the case of CBD and cannabinoids in general, they do appear to have some pharmaceutical beneficial effects in people. Do the benefits outweigh the risks? That's an individual basis that I will allow people to understand. What I suggest in the book is try and understand the root cause of the illness that you are treating with a pharmaceutical molecule, whether it's synthetic, fungal, or plant. Correct the root cause first, right? Are you treating anxiety? Are you treating insomnia? What are you treating? Can we correct those without the molecule? And if we can't, then use the molecule, but know that it may have some side effects associated with it. I think psilocybin is a great example of this, right? Psilocybin probably has side effects, but it can be very helpful. So do the benefits outweigh the risks? Specifically with regard to CBD, which is cannabidiol, and cannabidivarin, which is another cannabinoid, there is a study that I reference in the book that shows that they do break chromosomes in cell culture. Many polyphenols do. So, right, this is the concern, is if we're using it as a crutch and we don't really need it, if we're using it recreationally, probably not worth the benefits based on the risks. And I think we have to evaluate this with every molecule. That's what we do in medicine, right? If I'm going to prescribe somebody a statin, which I don't do anymore, nor would I probably ever do, I have to say, are the benefits worth the risks? That's what's being left out of, I think, the conversations regarding plant molecules. And there are different conversations about plant molecules as food versus pharmaceuticals. I think it's very clear that molecules can affect human physiology, whether they are synthetic, bacterial, fungal, or plant. It's just, what are they doing to us broadly? That's what's been left out of the equation.
Awesome, Paul. So here's another question. Gal goes from keto to carnivore, says overweight, or maybe not a gal, guy. He's overweight, seeing the fasting blood sugar is a little higher, 110. Any concerns with that? You think it's common? What's going on with that? I mean, this goes to diabetes in general. You know, we look at what is the pathophysiology going on with diabetes, and we've been so glucose focused. And I know guys like Jason Fung are saying it's insulin dependent. Now, you know, of course the plant-based guys, Neil Bernard, saying it's, no, it's all lipid deposits within cells, which are causing insulin resistance. And then even beyond that, there's people that are talking about, no, it's a mitochondrial dysfunction. So can you talk a little bit about diabetic pathophysiology and why this person's blood sugar may have gone up a little bit? Is it simply just they're eating more protein, which is probably, you know, anyway.
That's probably what's going on. Yeah. So I did a podcast yesterday with a couple of guys from Mastering Diabetes. They're basically fruitarian. And they put out this book, Mastering Diabetes. And they are saying that a very high carbohydrate, low fat diet can improve glucose handling and is lowering their use of insulin, which may be the case. And so this gets into some pretty complex physiology that I'll try and break down. I think you're right, Sean, but I think that everybody's talking about the same thing. So lipid deposits do appear to happen when we get insulin resistant. It does appear to involve mitochondria. It's all part of the same process. And for Neil Barnard or anyone to point to one piece of it is myopic. We have to zoom out and look at the entire pathophysiology. So basically, insulin resistance is not a specific enough term, because there is something that happens with low carbohydrate diets that could be termed insulin resistance, but is not the same as pathological insulin resistance that we see in diabetes. So this is one of the things I really hammered home with these guys and had to correct them on the podcast yesterday. Pathological insulin resistance, I think, is best thought of as hyperinsulinemia with hyperglycemia, right? Insulin resistance, it's not enough to say that cells are not responding to insulin, because many cells in the human body, specifically the muscle cells, will become insulin resistant, quote unquote, to the actions of insulin on a low carb diet. That is normal human healthy physiology. We can see that even after one low carbohydrate meal the night before. Sometimes women will go for OGTT in pregnancy, oral glucose tolerance testing. And if they have eaten a low carb day before, they will fail OGTT. Are they pathologically insulin resistant? No way. Not even the same thing. They are not hyperinsulinemic necessarily, and they do not have high levels of blood glucose. So what's the difference? The difference is where it's all coming from. So there, it's the kind of, I think it starts with the adipocyte, and it's when we try and stuff. So Jason Fung, I think, is on the right track here. When we try and stuff too many t-shirts into a suitcase, when we try and stuff too much energy into an adipocyte, that adipocyte, which has mitochondria, will send out signals to the body, right, to say, hey, we are full of energy. You should become resistant to the actions of insulin. And so in that situation, glucose is high and insulin remains high, but the adipocyte and the muscle cells will say, we are not responding to you, okay? And that is usually a caloric and mixed macronutrient overfeeding situation. Every person becomes insulin resistant at a different level of adipocyte expansion, okay? We know that Asians, for instance, can become insulin resistant much sooner. Caucasian Americans can get very fat, which may be a good or a bad thing, before their adipocyte starts sending out signals to the rest of the body. And the adipocyte generally sends out signals. It's two fatty acids, palmitic acid and palmitoleic acid. Palmitic acid is saturated, palmitoleic is unsaturated. In the setting when the adipocyte is full or the adipocyte is not responding to signals from insulin, it will send out palmitic acid. And that tells the muscles, you should become insulin resistant also. Don't take this up. We don't want any more substrate. So that is kind of what's driving insulin resistance, in my opinion. So mitochondria are involved, and this has to do with the production of reactive oxygen species. At the actual microscopic level of the mitochondria, you will see reactive oxygen species happening in the mitochondria, which will lead to more citrate going into the cytoplasm, and that will lead to more malonyl-CoA, and that will lead to insulin resistance at the level of the cell. That's very granular, but mitochondria are signaling insulin resistance because they are perceiving too much energy, okay? That is very different than a low carbohydrate glucose sparing physiology, in which because insulin is so low, the mitochondria say, hey, I'm not getting any signals from, the adipocyte say, I'm not getting any signals from insulin. I'm going to release palmitic acid. It's going to tell the muscles to spare glucose for the testicles, kidneys, eyes, red blood cells, and brain. But insulin is not high and glucose is not high. Hopefully that makes sense. They get confused. So we must define insulin resistance as not the refusal of certain cells to take up glucose in response to insulin. That is too broad a definition. Insulin resistance is hyperinsulinemia with hyperglycemia. And that is why a clamp test, so euglycemic hyperinsulinemic clamp test is flawed with regard to insulin resistance, because you can fail a euglycemic clamp if you are low carb. That doesn't mean you have pathological insulin resistance. So when people are saying this is a problem, we're saying, no. So if you guys have questions, listen to the podcast I did with Mastering Diabetes, not the same physiology at all. So I think that in diabetes, in insulin resistance that is pathological, this hyperinsulinemia is potentially driving a lot of the problems, whether it's smooth muscle cell hypertrophy in the vessel wall leading to ischemia and atherosclerosis or damaging the endothelium. There is something going on with this resulting hyperglycemia and hyperinsulinemia. I think those are the problem. Not necessarily that the muscle is saying, I don't want to listen to your signals, or the adipocyte is saying, I don't want to listen to your signals. It's all this extra glucose in your blood. It's all this extra insulin in your body. We know that hormones get out of whack. Things get problematic, right? We get acromegaly. We get problems if there's too much growth hormone. We get problems if there's too much thyroid hormone. Hyperinsulinemia is akin to hyperthyroidism or another hyperhormone syndrome. I think that's driving a lot of the pathology and insulin resistance, potentially that in addition to the inflammation that can underlie it. The last thing I'll say here, this is kind of technical discussion, hopefully it's helpful, is that when we are inflamed, if we are inflamed for some reason, we know by injecting lipopolysaccharide, for instance, into people, we can make them insulin resistant more quickly. So if we are inflamed, our adipocytes signal cut off insulin much more quickly than they do if we are not inflamed. So that is the changing threshold of insulin resistance in the context of inflammation. Rising glucose, especially morning blood glucose on a low carb diet, is probably just gluconeogenesis ramping up. And we know this can happen, right? Gluconeogenesis ramps up when there is less of an insulin signal often. And It's actually part of the physiology with diabetes and pathologic insulin resistance is that there is inappropriate gluconeogenesis happening in that situation. In this situation, it's probably appropriate gluconeogenesis driven by that AM cortisol awakening response that's going on for people. So I don't think that's as much of a problem. And if they had questions, that's where a CGM, a continuous blood glucose monitor, becomes very useful. And what you see is that morning blood glucose might be the highest and then it might go down from there. And I will mention that hemoglobin A1C appears to be a very inaccurate measure of average blood glucose, especially on low carb diets. So I think that a 110 in the morning would kind of raise my eyebrow a little bit. I would wonder about fat to protein ratios and a few other things. Salt, are they getting enough salt? We know that salt restriction could cause insulin resistance. I'd probably dig into that a little bit. It's more likely, or it's more normal for me to see morning blood glucose is 90, 95, high 80s is not unusual. A 110 makes me think there's probably a little more to dig into, but I do think that's probably just a cortisol phenomenon and increased gluconeogenesis rather than pure pathologic insulin resistance. You could test it by checking the insulin level. And if there's not hyperinsulinemia, you've got something else going on here.
Yeah, good point. One thing I'll add onto that, Paul. I mean, I know Neil Bernard's issue, saturated fat causes the deposition of fat. I had Ben Bickman and we talked about the fact that what's driving the saturated fat in the blood is not ingested.
Exactly.
It's insulin. And so, and then the other thing, it was kind of interesting. I had Chabatoth on, I think, 2 weeks ago, and we talked about it. And he really seemed to think that insulin is kind of a secondary effect of distraction. It's still the gut permeability. And this is something, I know you pointed to LPS, which is obviously a gut permeability issue in the actual context of a human being. That's where that's coming from. So let me get on to another question. I know we can talk for all day. We don't have much time, Paul. I want to get to some of these questions. So, and I'm apologizing. There's no way I'm going to get to the 40 more questions. But I'm gonna combine this one. This is a little thing that you and I kind of go back and forth on a little bit. And there's a person saying, hey, what about nutrient deficiencies? Have you measured on carnivore? Is it avoid organ meats? Is there something else we can add? Or egg sufficient? And then there's somebody says, well, what do you have to say about people? Dr. Lisa, who's been doing it for 10 years and doesn't do that stuff and doesn't really have any issues. And so is this a conditional thing? Are there certain people that are going to do better with organ meats? Is it essential for all people? What is your general thought on that?
Yeah, so I know you and I disagree a little bit on this, but I think we're probably more similar than people imagine. I think, look, if somebody is thriving, who am I to tell them what to do? You know, like if somebody is thriving eating only meat and ribeyes, like do it, you know, like that's great. What I generally see is increased homocysteine and low blood levels of folate when people are not eating organ meats, and probably low blood levels of riboflavin, which is not as commonly measured. And blood levels of riboflavin are not a great indicator. We have to use something called an EGRAC, which is an erythrocyte glutathione, you know, reduction quotient. It's like, that's not even going to be doable. So I think, here's what I think. Like, I don't see a lot of downside to organs other than our conditioning as humans and the fact that a lot of us aren't used to eating them. I think that they're often cheaper than muscle meat. A lot of people seem to like them once they get the hang of them. I've kind of made light of the fact that I'll eat any organ, and it's kind of fun to eat any organ. And I think that that's probably the way that most indigenous people would have eaten. But if people are thriving without them, great. What I'm trying to do is kind of similar to what you're trying to do, Shawn, and just give people a roadmap and say, hey, look, if you're not thriving, remember that you may need organ meats, that organ meats may be helpful. I think they're pretty beneficial for most people, and I would encourage them to try them with things like liver and kidney being the first ones. Heart is also great. Heart has a little more riboflavin. But I have to extend that statement also. Like, if people are thriving on a plant-based diet, which I think is very unusual, like, who am I to tell them to change their diet, right? But I think that there's a lot of benefits to organ meats, and I have seen very low blood levels of folate and pretty high levels of homocysteine and low levels of riboflavin in people without getting them, who are not getting them. And then you think like, well, the more we dig into it, there's all kinds of good stuff in them as well. Like, you know, a little more selenium or a little more biotin or a little more vitamin C in some of the organ meats. So who knows? I see it as a bonus on top of it. And I think we're not sure yet. And I just want to caution people regarding that. And in my clients, I generally see that they do better when their homocysteine is low. And when it goes high, it's correlational, but they don't seem to do as well when the homocysteine is above 7 or 8.
Yeah, so I think that the good point here, Paul, is hopefully as time goes by, we'll get some studies on this. Obviously, it's all speculative, and we're like, does that blood glucose or you know whatever serum level we're looking at, does it actually translate into clinical stuff down the road? Obviously, that's really, really hard to test to make sure of. But I mean, I certainly agree. If you're not feeling good, there's no harm in adding it. And certainly, conversely, there's people that add it and see no significant benefit. So I want to ask, let's see, this is another common question. And unfortunately, well, I'll see if you have a better answer than I do, but this is a question from postmenopausal woman. They have a hard time losing weight. What's the deal there? What can I do with a carnivore? Why am I not losing weight?
So I did a podcast with L. Russ that'll be out in the next few weeks, and it was all about thyroid. So people a lot of times will ask me that. It's funny, Shawn, because I get things on both sides. I'll have people say, I'm losing too much weight on carnivore, and other people saying, I can't lose weight on carnivore. And I think, wow, this is really individual, you know, like there's more, you know. I think what we learned from this is it's more than just there's a context, just like LDL is context, like CBD is context, probably organs are contextual, and it's not a satisfying answer. As much as I hate it when people say this, you know, there really is no one size fits all. I think there is, you know, one size fits most, and there are broad strokes that we can make that will be helpful for a lot of people. But when I hear that, that someone's not losing weight, I think, do we have a full thyroid panel? Do I have TSH? Do I have free T3? Do I have free T4? Do I have reverse T3? Do I have anti-TPO and anti-thyroglobulin antibodies? Do I have an adrenal panel? You know, what does their adrenal index look like throughout the day? Are they getting a cortisol awakening response? Are they not dropping it, right? So I got to think thyroid. I got to think adrenals. I also want to think pituitary hormones. I want to see TSH. I want to see FSH and LH. It's like, it becomes like, okay, now we need to expand the lens. Then I want to think, well, are they inflamed, right? We talked about this with regard to insulin resistance. If somebody has a big gut dysbiosis and they have underlying inflammation, then they're not going to lose weight because they're going to be more insulin resistant, or if their cortisol is through the roof. So once we get that, it's like, okay, this is a person that we really need to kind of dissect and look at 24-hour cortisol curves, hormones, micronutrients as well. Like, are they missing a micronutrient? Is there something going on there? So that's when I expand the lens and kind of look in a little more deeply, because I think there's something else going on there. Those are fascinating cases, though, because for the majority of people, we know that this type of diet is really going to help with weight loss. And when it doesn't work, I think there's something else going on. You got to turn over more stones, as I say in the book. I'm sorry, that's not a specific answer. I can't tell that person specifically why they're not losing weight, but do all those things, gut stuff, thyroid stuff, micronutrient stuff, cortisol stuff, kind of expand and be like, what's the imbalance here? And kind of go from there.
Yeah. And I guess the well, again, this, you know, we could talk forever, Paul, but what, you know, the answer becomes, and what do you do? Is there a dietary change, or is it become medication changes? I mean, I know that's a lot of topic, and we don't want to go into individual on all of them. Let me go to another question. Somebody talks about, is it possible to do a carbohydrate-based carnivore diet with clean carb source? I don't want to keto adapt right now. I guess they're asking, you know, do carbs
absolutely
on this diet, and what are your thoughts on carbs? And I pointed out, in my view, I don't think quote unquote carbohydrates are bad. I think it's more the plant toxins, what they're wrapped with. But what are your thoughts on carbohydrates in the context of a, I guess you call it a meat-based diet in that case?
I mean, they're there. Honey is the magic, right? And this is one of the things I was thinking this morning that I'd wish I'd written a little bit differently in my book. So I've got to talk to some of my dental friends about this more, but you may know Al Dannenberg. I think he said you were talking to him, Shawn.
He's coming on our podcast in the near future. We just had to reschedule. Zach was sick the other day.
too many plants. So Al Dannenberg is a periodontist, and he told me that people will brush their teeth with honey, and that reports of tooth decay with honey have to do with the sort of the sap that is often eaten with the honey, and it keeps things kind of stuck to the teeth. But it was funny because I was talking to James DiNicolantonio this morning. We were chatting about fructose and sugars and salt after a podcast I did with Lauren Cordain yesterday. And James was saying the same thing, that that honey has been shown to decrease tooth decay. And I thought, isn't that fascinating? So honey, we're still learning, right? Honey may be a very carnivore source for carbohydrates if you do not want to keto adapt. If you want to carb cycle or do any of those things, honey might be a great source. And in the book, Perhaps this will be heresy among this community. I offer what I would consider to be a carnivore-ish diet. And I offer a spectrum of plant toxicity for people who are not wanting to go full carnivore. And I do think there are some plants, as you suggest, Shawn, that will have less toxins wrapping around their carbohydrates. And my conceptualization here is non-sweet fruits, squash, avocado, olives, that sort of thing. Maybe honey, honey definitely, and some other people, I think would be a reasonable thing to use carbohydrates. I think you do not have to be ketogenic on a carnivore diet. Though I will say that the more I think about this, and again, this is just conjecture, but I think this is so much fun to think about. I cannot imagine that our ancestors were not in ketosis for at least half of the time, you know? And, you know, Lauren Cordain has been an outspoken proponent against ketogenic diets, but I wanted to kind of nail him down and say, are you against ketosis or are you against the way that ketogenic diets are conducted? Chris Masterjohn, obviously not a fan of ketogenic diets, but I think Chris actually is not a fan of ketones either. And that just kind of baffled, like, how can anyone not be a fan of beta hydroxybutyrate in a context? That's like saying you're not a fan of glucose, which Chris said, like, you don't think glucose is toxic, do you? And I said, no, glucose is not toxic, but neither is beta hydroxybutyrate. Like, most people, Chris Masterjohn included, eating 200, 300 grams of carbs a day, if they're working out a lot, they might even end up with ketones in their blood in the morning when they wake up after a fast. And so for them to believe that that beta hydroxybutyrate circulating in the morning is somehow killing them and they have to just slam in carbohydrates so that they don't get hurt by this beta hydroxybutyrate is kind of crazy to me. So I don't think beta hydroxybutyrate is harmful to humans, nor do I think acetoacetate is harmful to humans. Those are the two major ketones that kind of isomerize in the human body. But I think there are questions, you know, does everyone react to full ketogenic diets all the time? We're still learning. And I think that it's useful to incorporate some notion of possible carbohydrate inclusion to see how you feel. And I think honey would be the first choice, and then non-toxic or less toxic carbohydrates than some of the other ones that we talked about.
Yeah, and somebody asked a question about what fruit and vegetables would you give their kids or something like that, which is kind of similar. Somebody said, I'm going to skip to this question. Why don't other carnival animals have huge brains? You know, I guess you're talking about lions and wolves. And I mean, honestly, I mean, compared to the equal size herbivores, they do have relatively big brains. But this is a point I want to get your opinion on, because when we talk about growing the brain, you know, you know, and we look through the anthropology, with regard to fasting and feasting, my sort of hypothesis is if we went through long periods of fasting between meals, I don't know that we would have grown as big of a brain. I think we would have had access to continuous high nutrient value fats, particularly frequently to grow that brain. What are your thoughts on that, those topics? You just muted yourself, Paul. You're on mute, Paul. Paul, you muted yourself. You're on mute.
Unmute myself. Okay, there we get it. Okay, good.
There you go.
And when I tried to unmute myself, it said the host muted you. And I was like, Shawn, I need you to unmute me. I didn't know that.
No, I didn't mute you.
I know, but it was like, it wouldn't let me. Anyway, all right. What is the question about access to fasting? And yeah, I mean, I think that consistent access to food is important. To humans, and excessive amounts of fasting are problematic, and I wouldn't overdo it. Is that the question? I was too busy.
The question was about why don't other carnivores have big brains, dogs, you know, cats, lions?
Oh, good question. Had never thought about that.
I have, Paul, and if you do a comparison relative to body size,
yeah,
animals have much bigger brains than herbivores of equivalent size. So I think that fact is important first of all.
Yeah. And you know, maybe it was something else about, you could also make an argument that it's fat. Just off the top of my head, I'm thinking, so this actually came up with Lauren Cordain yesterday in the podcast. I thought it was a very fascinating thing. If we imagine that humans can be carnivores, which seems to be fairly clear that we can be, you know, in order for humans to be carnivores, we need to get more fat in our diet than like a lion or a cat, or another obligate carnivores like tigers, because of this enzyme in the liver that is involved in the deamination of proteins and the formation of your apparently cat and other obligate carnivores. They can upregulate that enzyme almost infinitely and can eat more and more protein almost without a ceiling. But humans don't appear to be able to do that. That's rabbit starvation, right? That we can't do that. But I think that maybe one hypothesis would be that because we are limited in the amount of protein, we need to get more fat in our diet. So that has meant that generally humans get more fat in our diet than other obligate carnivores. If you look at the kind of animals that most obligate carnivores, hyena, or a lion or a tiger are eating, they are lower fat than what humans will need to thrive on a carnivore diet, and lower fat than many of the mega fauna that we were hunting. So I suspect, or one plausible hypothesis may be, that our brains got so big because we were hunting very fat animals. And is it something in the fat? Is it K2 in the fat? Is it DHA in the fat? Is it unique access to something on these fattier animals that allowed our brains to grow? Because generally, as humans, we are eating fattier animals than another obligate carnivore would be. That's just the one thing that I think of off the top of my head, because we have that ceiling for protein at around 35, 40% of calories. Everybody might draw it a little differently, but there is a ceiling for protein in humans appearing to be present in our physiology. So we need some fat. Are there magical things in the fat for humans? Probably. But if you look at a deer, not a lot of fat. The smaller the animal, the lower body fat. A squirrel, 4% body fat. And then you go up to like a bear, they get to be more. And, you know, humans probably were seeking out animals that were about 15% body fat or more, which is a pretty big animal. Then you're looking at like buffalo, bison, and bigger would be ideal for humans. And this is kind of the argument around the anthropology argument around current hunter-gatherers. They're not able to hunt animals big enough to get enough fat. So they may need to include some plant foods in their diet. But then the question becomes, if we can have access to animals, because we're lucky today, that recapitulate the woolly mammoth, and we can get as much fat as we want, or we can get large amounts of fat, or 30% of fat in our diet, which is really a luxury, does that change the way we are as humans? Does that allow for us to exclude plants from our diet because we don't really need carbohydrates anymore? I suspect it does.
Well, I want to go to another topic here, Paul. There's a couple people that are talking about gout and oxalates. Some guy said, I had gout, now it went away. Another guy said, I've been on the carnivore diet, now I have a gout flare. What are your thoughts on gout? I know I've had my discussions on that, but I'd like to hear your perspective. And do we confuse oxalates, recrystallization with gout? Or anyway, just talk about uric acid, gout, oxalates perhaps, if you can, in 5 minutes.
Interesting stuff. Yeah. I need to jump off soon too. So the only client of mine on a carnivore diet that's had a problem with gout ate fructose. So when people are getting gout on a carnivore diet, I really want to dig into their physiology and know exactly what they're eating. Lactose is glucose and galactose. Is a milk sugar changing things? Is milk sugar changing physiology in connection with uric acid? So technically in medicine, we think of gout as uric acid deposition in joints. This is actually a really fascinating topic. One of the things we know, or I would say most of us believe, is that it's not a linear relationship between blood uric acid levels and deposition in joints, because uric acid rises when we fast. But fasting doesn't usually cause gout in most of us. I've seen people have blood uric acid levels over 10, and they don't get gout. And then some people get a blood uric acid level of 7 and they get gout. So what is going on there? There's probably something else going on. I suspect it has to do with underlying insulin resistance. Is there inflammation? There's probably another piece of the puzzle, that uric acid is contextual. Peter Attia did a recent podcast that I was just kind of scratching my head about. And it was a guy talking about how bad uric acid was, and just really railing on uric acid, saying uric acid causes hypertension, blah, blah, blah. And I'm thinking, Peter, ask the guy the question about fasting. Of course, Peter Attia never asked him about fasting, because Peter has talked about the fact that when he does fast, because Peter likes to do these week-long fasts every quarter, his uric acid goes through the roof. And I'm thinking, man, you've got to ask this guy the question. I was so disappointed. There's more to it than just uric acid rising and depositing in joints, it appears. Uric acid also may have a protective role. There's some studies I've talked about in the past that the uric acid is actually coupled with glutathione and may serve an antioxidant role with glutathione. People hypothesize that we evolved uric acid. Bruce Ames has suggested this as an antioxidant to take some of the role of vitamin C when we lost the ability to synthesize it. So uric acid, I think to paint uric acid as completely bad is doesn't make a lot of sense. I know Amber's talked about this as well in some of her talks. It's a complex story. If someone is getting gout on a carnivore diet, I would say, are you insulin resistant? Are you having some fruit? Is there some fructose? Is there something else in the context there that we're missing? Are you using dairy? Could that be confounding things? It's a complex equation. Oxalates are fascinating. And of course, if you actually aspirate a joint, we should be able to make a definitive diagnosis of gout. So if somebody is having a definitive diagnosis of gout with, you know, refracting crystals that are refract in the light and we can see uric acid crystals on someone's joint with carnivore, then we have a question. But I don't know. I mean, I've had other people say like, oh, my joint is aching. And I'm thinking that's not gout, or maybe it's oxalate deposition. We don't know. I think the oxalates are fascinating and this big thing that no one really understands. In the book, I've got a whole chapter about this where I talk about all the places in the body that oxalate has been found to be deposited. And gosh, you know, that's a big deal. Like, we have oxalate in the thyroid and the breast tissue of both men and women. And, you know, there's probably oxalate in like our genitals, and this is vulvar pain syndrome in some people. And like, why are we getting oxalate in all these parts of our body? This can't be a good thing. And I think that I really look forward to all of us understanding more what oxalate dumping looks like, how to deal with it, who oxalates are bad for, what kind of symptoms these could be causing, because there's certainly a lot of suspicion that I have that it could be a major problem. Did that answer the question, Shawn?
You know, it's obviously, it's an interesting topic. We did a nice podcast, HPO, with a guy named Morgan Fiffner, which I think is good. And we know that gout also, there's immunologic things that affect gout. There's temperature, there's acidity. And that's why big toe is where it comes in, just because the big toe is colder. I mean, there's just a lot of things that go into why it deposits, why it crystallizes. And, you know, you see people with that 6.8, I think, what is it, milligrams per deciliter? I think, I can't remember the units on that, but that's kind of chill for gout. And, you know, I've seen people with 10 plus. Another question here, I think, is fruit versus vegetables in general toxicity. Some people would say, hey, clearly we ate fruit, you know, when we evolved, we came from frugivorous animals potentially. Plants want us to eat their fruit. Is fruit less toxic than vegetables? Thoughts on that?
I think it is, generally speaking, as long as we don't overconsume it. Brett is shaking his head up there. I think it is. I think fruit is less toxic than vegetables. I'm not saying fruit is good for humans or is a critical part of our diet. I think that it's generally less toxic than vegetables, if I had to make a spectrum. And again, I think we'll look at animals like bears and primates. Overconsumption of fruit does appear to lead to obesity. And I think that overconsumption of fructose does appear to lead to insulin resistance. Now, there's probably a threshold, and it's within what's reasonable. If we go out and eat 3 pounds of grapes, pretty sure that's not going to be great for a human. I don't know that we ever would have done that, right? So I'm not saying fruit is not problematic and that's probably dose dependent, but is a small amount of fruit better than a small amount of vegetables? In my opinion, it could be. And a lot of fruit that we eat today, though not all of it, is hybridized and made to look much more sweet than it used to be. So lots of things can play in here. But yes, generally speaking, I think fruit is less toxic than vegetables. I'm not saying it's completely benign, nor am I feeling that it has an indispensable role in the human diet. So hopefully that makes Brett feel a little bit better. And I think, you know, in the book, I talk about a plant toxicity spectrum and, you know, berries. You know, there's not a lot of fruit and there's not a lot of sugar in those, a lot less fructose. People want to eat that occasionally. If they don't react to it, it's probably pretty reasonable. I suspect our ancestors would have been after fruit as a calorie and as a survival calorie. One of the fascinating things in the conversation I had with Lauren Cordain and his crew yesterday was that there's a tribe of uncontacted hunter-gatherers in the Amazon, and they basically eat meat and fruit, and they shun the leaves and stems of plants knowing that they are full of toxins. Now, that was kind of interesting. And then I wondered, well, if they could always get peccary, which is like basically a javelina or a pig, would they even need to eat fruit? Is there a benefit to the fruit? Who knows? But that was kind of cool. Like, there's these uncontacted hunter-gatherers at the equator, which is where fruit is going to be the most available. Chris Masterjohn has kind of challenged me with this concept. Like, if you go near the equator, people eat more vegetables, people eat more plants. And it's like, yeah, but they're not eating more stems and leaves and roots. They're eating more fruit. And generally speaking, these people are eating like very small amounts of stems and leaves and roots of plants. And so it's like, yeah, I think fruit is less toxic. And if we're eating the fruit in the Amazon, and if we'd grown up, evolved in the Amazon, we probably would be adapted to that. But then there's this uricase mutation. People have hypothesized that increases the amount of uric acid in the human body. And there's a compelling hypothesis that arose in northerners for cold winters to allow for more fat storage when we ate fruit. Something about uric acid makes fructose more more lipogenic. It creates more de novo lipogenesis from fructose when you have a higher uric acid. So we get fatter with fruit, potentially as a survival mechanism to outlast northern winters. That's not a good thing for those of us that don't need to outlast northern winters anymore and have plenty of calories all the time. So I don't think it's a great thing for most of us long term, but it probably is less toxic and it's a little more consistent ancestrally.
Paul, I'm going to add a comment. It's totally unrelated. I want to ask two last quick questions because we're going to run out of time. Why, you know, I saw an interesting study. I know you've talked about the problems with seafood. There was an interesting study that Michael Richards, who does some of the isotopic data, Richards, I'm sure you're familiar with, on Neanderthals and whatnot, but he looked at a study looking at Pacific Islanders and looking at their isotopic data, and it showed that they, despite living on islands, they basically ate pig, and the thing is, they noticed that they fed the pigs fish. So they used the fish to feed the pigs, which fed the humans, which I thought was very interesting observation. But I want to talk about raw meat. I know there's a lot of people that call me an idiot because I don't eat all my, I dare to cook my meat. And I know you've gone to cooking more of your meat. So thoughts on raw versus uncooked meat, or cooked versus uncooked meat. And then also dairy is obviously a hot topic. People talk about the different types of dairy, A2 versus raw dairy. Any thoughts on those two topics?
Yeah. So I'm with you, Shawn. Cooked meat is way better than raw meat. I've definitely eaten tartare in the past. I like it. I don't eat much of my meat. I eat most of my organs raw. I like them better that way, but I don't eat the meat raw anymore. And I think that cooked or raw is probably fine for people with meat. I just found that one of the things I found that I couldn't really figure this out was that raw meat was very filling and I could not eat enough. And I wanted to eat more. And I could eat more cooked meat. I'll eat about a pound and a half, 2 pounds of meat a day. For me, I'm about 175 pounds right now. So I don't think raw meat is necessary. If people are thriving on raw meat, great. I tend to feel like cooked meat is a little better. I don't cook it all the way through though. And I like my organs raw. That's just kind of how I do it, but it's a fascinating question. I think that humans have been cooking for a long time. And then seafood is a fascinating thing. Gosh, we better know where that seafood is coming from. And we've polluted the oceans. Certainly heavy metals are a big deal in seafood. And if we're eating tuna or other fish, even salmon now has a lot of mercury. You got to be really careful with this. And inland deposits, I mean, you know, freshwater bodies are much higher in persistent organic pollutants and things. It's, I don't know. Seafood is swimming in it. Ruminants are just breathing it. So I think ruminants are cleaner, and I don't make seafood a big part of my diet, nor do I think it's essential. I think we can get omega-3s and the nutrients we need from land animals. Eggs have iodine. Meat has a little iodine. I think there's a lot of ways to get iodine if we're talking about that. I don't think we need massive doses of omega-3 in our diet. And then what was the last question there?
Dairy.
Yeah. I try not to be biased by my own experience here. I've tried to reintroduce dairy 5 times and every single time I get bad reactions. So it doesn't work for me, you know, and I've done A1, I've done A2, I've done raw goat's milk, I've done fermented. Look, I'm just sensitive to whey and casein. And I think that probably there are others who are as well. But I mean, one of the things that keeps coming up in these discussions is, look, there might be a small amount of people who can do dairy and thrive on it. In that case, great. In general, I recommend that people eliminate it from their diet and see how they feel and then add it back in and kind of go from there. That's kind of how I feel about coffee. I'm not really a fan, but if people eliminate coffee and feel better, look, you did the experiment for yourself. I'm not a fan of dairy. I think it's going to affect satiety negatively for people potentially. It's delicious. And I think there's a reason it's delicious because it was kind of this mirroring of this ancestral thing that we got from our breast of the mom. And that's, babies are supposed to overconsume that. This combination of fat and carbohydrate, I think, can short circuit human satiety mechanisms. That's an oversimplification, but if you look at a lot of junk food, it's fat and carbohydrate together. And you better believe that if you put, sugar on something that's fatty, your body is just going to go bonkers. And I think that recapitulates breast milk and junk food. And that's maybe not something we want to do all the time in terms of insulin resistance and overall satiety and health for humans. And that's, I think that is what breaks the fat cells, actually, is when we over consume fat and carbohydrates together, that breaks the fat cells. Again, that's a very broad strokes explanation, but you can see carbohydrate overfeeding. If you just feed somebody bagels they will get insulin resistant much more slowly than we would expect without fat. If you just feed someone fat, they're not really going to get insulin resistant, and they're not really going to accumulate extra fat. We can do these overfeeding studies. When you overfeed fat and carbs together, boom, as soon as you get over your caloric threshold, you will do de novo lipogenesis. You will convert that carbohydrate into fat. You will store that fat. It's a very rare situation, I think, in humans to have fat and carbohydrate together in large amounts in nature. And I think that's a signal like, whoa, this is a very rare thing. This is either breast milk from the mom or some crazy bounty. You better eat the heck out of this because you don't know if it's going to happen tomorrow. And I think it just doesn't seem to work very well with our biology. I apologize. That's a very rudimentary explanation, but hopefully it explains it to people.
Well, wonderful, man. I know we both got to go. I apologize, guys. There's no way I can get to all these questions. 140 messages still in the queue. So anyway, Paul has he's great at doing these things. So Paul, maybe hopefully we get you back on sometime.
Absolutely. Thanks, you guys. I appreciate you all. Check out the book. Again, it's on Amazon now. I'm going to link the Carnivore Code book to the link on Amazon. That one goes to the ebook now. It'll all get merged in the next 48 hours. I'm not sharing the Amazon link yet. I'm going to do an announcement like early in the next 24 to 48. So if you want to go check out the book, the print is available. Ebook will be out on Saturday on the 22nd. And thank you guys. I appreciate you all. It's a fun conversation. Thanks for having me on, Shawn. I love you, brother. Awesome. I got to get you one of these, man.
Yeah, yeah. Cool, man. All right. Take care, guys.
Take care, guys.
All right. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.